This presentation was designed for Stefano, that is the official speaker for Cashbox. But however, now he's missing, so I'm going to present it. Let's start. Imagine that you are a night out with your friends, you are having a dinner, you are drinking. At some part of the night, there's someone that wants to play social games or board games, but no one brought it. And so you can play. Why? Because the main problems related with board game is that you need money to buy them, that they are cumbersome, so it's not so comfortable to bring your car games, for example, with your scooter or your bike. And if you want to play and you are missing that tiny part that makes all the experience nice, enjoyable, you can't play anymore. So, what is our solution? Our solution is to provide a services that has no advertising, it's free for everyone, and you can play it everywhere. But how? Well, it's easy, with a smartphone. And we know that we bring our smartphone really everywhere. So, our solution is named Carbox, and is an application that offer three different sets of games. The first are those games that are really fast and you can play it everywhere in every situation. The second kind of games are those games where you need to talk and you need to recitate, you need to have a relationship with the other players. And the third category of games are those games where you really need to do your best in order to win. And it's really important for us to make clear that our experience is out of the box and out of the smartphone. So, why Carbox is different from table games? Because first of all, the setup is really easy, because we are going to develop a design and user design experience where the setup is easy. You can make trial games in order to understand the rules, and thanks to vibration, flash, lights, and sound, the experience is something really new. For what concerns mobile games, it's really important for us, the social aspect, that we don't want people to stare idiotically to the smartphone. We want people to talk all together and to have fun. At the same time, it's really important to create a flow of the game experience. We don't want any interruption. We don't want advertising bother you with buy this stuff in order to complete the games. It's not what we want. And where are the money? How does it work? Where we can find the money? Well, our business model is based on three pillars. There are the community of players, the major companies, and those kind of people that are independent creators. So people that would like to create a board of social games, but so far they're not finding any space. So we want to start with developing a series of Creative Commons games in order to attract the gamers, and soon offer a mix of between free and paid games, and to be able to alternate and create scalability to that games in order to provide always new experience. It's never boring. For what concerns the independent creators, first of all, we give them the possibility to boost their ideas. Then we give a lot of insights due to the possibility that we have to track the mobile experience. And the most important, thanks to licensing, they can create value for us, providing games, but at the same time, they have rewards, they have money. And for the third part, there are different solutions for major companies. This field is not so clear, but because what is really important are the first two, because we need players and we need people to develop and create games, because we don't want to be games creators. But for the major companies, could be really interesting, because we can sell a spots for their advertising. So if you are, I don't know, Hasbro, and you want to create your own game, we can sell our premium spot in the application. At the same time, if you are Hasbro and you don't want to develop your game, we can develop it according to our, let's say, ludic system. And third, we can provide those insights that are really beneficial for your business intelligence. To conclude, this is our team. There are three computer science students of University of Pisa. That's me, and this is a designer. And thank you for your attention, and that's all.
So does anyone have a doubt that he lives and breathes this this business? Right? You can see, obviously, he's practiced this a lot. They've gone through it every slide. He's gone through the flow. He's practiced it how many times? Wow. This is different than PhD Plus.
20 hours for writing the slides.
Right. Yeah, I know. And he also happens to be the person who is in media economics, right? Yeah, and he's the one that actually connected with me at LinkedIn. And he also did the posting in the Endure group, which I responded to, right? So he also went through PhD Plus, so he has a bit of an advantage over everyone else because that was an 8-week program, and he did very well at the end. I think you were one of the top. Right, you weren't the speaker, but so also his team, multiple people on his team can do this presentation equally well. Okay, so his partner, you can see the name is with somebody else's name, Stefano. Okay.
Right.
Right. Okay, our speaker is going to enter. And first question, how much does it cost? How does he make money? Go ahead.
No, just to, from the point of view of communication, the first slide is suggesting where is the trick, no? Because you in the first slide, second slide, you have the glasses of champagne that says it's free. I think it's free, and this promise is not maintained in my opinion at the end because some games are paid. So you probably. It's in my impression. As a customer, I saw the presentation as a customer. It's very good, but it's just a bit of clashing information from the start and the end. Probably just saying can be free instead of is free. Yeah, exactly. So it's like a promise here. It's like a promise, and it suggests what is the trick? No ads, free. Everywhere it's okay, but what is the trick?
So our invited speaker is going to come in.
Okay.
Let's thank Leonardo. We'll spend some time. Everyone should use him as a resource, obviously, because he did a very good job, I think. Right, of this, I would like to see it even better from now until Saturday, so I'll spend some time with him, but use him as a resource as well. You should spend time with the others and helping them, okay? He used this slide being thing, so it gives him this animation benefit, okay? All right, so let's thank Leonardo and we'll talk.
Okay, so as promised, we start with an invited speaker to our summer school. We start by thanking him for finding a slot in his busy agenda around the world. Andrea Pontremoli is the CEO of Dallara. Dallara is in itself a case study for most of us, for people in engineering, in various branches of engineering, for people in competition and sport, for people in business. Because the outstanding results they have achieved also are a case study in business schools, and increasingly they will be so in the future. We've asked Andrea Pontremoli to talk about, of course, Dallara, but also about the philosophy that underlies the success of this company that has a broader lesson for all of you. For all of you that are busy in these 2 weeks to work on your startup, and hopefully you will put your setup in a ramp, in a launch in the next few weeks and months. We have planned to have some 1 hour presentation or something like that, and then intensive questions and answers. Among you, there are also people that are from the School of Engineering working on a team actually developing cars, sport cars, and we hope there will be time after that to let them talk and interact with you. And again, Andrea, we are really grateful for having you here.
Thank you.
You have your own.
Yes. Microphone. So it's a pleasure to be with you today. I have prepared two little things. One is a video. It lasts 4 minutes, so very fast video. They give you an idea of what we do, and you can see things. And then I have a presentation where I put together some things about our company. So first of all is to present you our company, but not because I want to sell anything to you, but to give you also the idea of the transformation that we have had during the 40 years of this company, and also some ideas of new business models that we are developing on our Dallara company. So, first of all, let's start with this video. You will see three basic things here. One is our territory, our area, our landscape. Because I am firmly convinced that in the near future, the competition will not be among companies, but will be among different territories in the world. If you ask me, who is your biggest competitor in the world? I cannot tell you another company, but I can tell you another territory. The territory is the Oxfordshire in UK, where we have McLaren, Mercedes, Red Bull, Lotus, Force India. And the other territory in the world where you can have the same kind of ideas is on the Motor Valley in Emilia-Romagna, where in 100 kilometers you can find Dallara, Pagani, Lamborghini, Maserati, Alfa Romeo, Ferrari, Ducati, Toro Rosso. We are all there. So keep in mind these kind of things, and I think you can really understand that if you look around the world, you go to the Silicon Valley, it's a territory, it's not one company. For sure, we have several companies that grew up there, but because you have an environment that starts from the education, then lend to the different kind of startups that are growing in this territory that help the common business model. And so what we are doing as a company, we foster this kind of territory, and I will explain you how. The second thing that you will see is how we work inside, the technology that we use. And remember, technology doesn't mean innovation. Technology is simply a tool. But remember, if you have a wrong business model and you put technology inside this wrong business model, technology gives you speed. And it means that you go in bankruptcy much rapidly than if you don't put technology there. So remember this. Sometimes technology is really dangerous, because the first most important thing is to check your business model, and then you can apply the technology. If you use the technology only because you want speed, if you are going in the wrong direction, it's better that you stop. And the third thing is the real secret of our success, of our company. And you will see, our secret are the people. I never saw a company in my life very successful or very innovative without innovative people. You can put business models, you go to internet, you find tons of different kinds of successful business models. But what makes the difference are the people. And so my job as a CEO, the most important thing is to select and create an environment where our people can grow up and they can put their innovative ideas on the ground. So this video, in 4 minutes, you have these three things. Here you see our our valley, Ceno Valley, is where I live. Here is the Lamborghini Miura, that is the first car that has been designed by Engineer Dallara. And here is my small town, Castello di Bardi, is where I live. And this is the road that goes to my company, Dallara. It lasts 21 minutes to arrive to the company. And if there is some traffic, could be 22 minutes. But this is the range. Here you can see Engineer Dallara. The founder of the company is still working in the company from 8 o'clock in the morning to 8 o'clock in the evening. He is 80 years old this year, but is very energetic and very, very clever. And here you see our racetrack in Varano. That is where we have the company. And the other racetrack is Indianapolis in US, where we have won last Sunday the 500 miles of Indianapolis in US. 550,000 people looking to this event, sit down in the racetrack. It was really an experience. Here you see what we do. Composite material, so carbon fiber, is how the company is structured. And you see that there's a lot of manual things that you have to do. It's not only brain, but also how to apply the things in the reality. Here is to show some technologies. This is the 7-post rig and how we work. Open space, all together, and the extensive use of the technology. For example, here you have the 3D machines. We have 7 additive manufacturing machines that where we build up the models for the wind tunnel. We own 2 wind tunnels, this is one. Is where we test the aerodynamics of our cars. This is an IndyCar model that is tested in the wind tunnel. Then we have another technology that I show you in a minute, that I will explain a little bit later on how this technology has changed our business model. That is this tool, is the simulator, the driving simulator. This video, you can find it in the YouTube. You put Dallara corporate video, you can find this video. So it's available in over the net. And this, to tell you in a word what we can do with this simulator, a driver, professional driver, can drive a car without the car produced. So he can drive a car that was never built. He drives only mathematical models. And is so precise and so reliable that we use it to develop our cars. And here, the last thing is the victory of the 500 miles of Indianapolis, the most important race in the world. And is for sure, for us, is really, we are very proud about this. But behind this victory, there is this group of people. It's a very small amount of people that are able to win all over the world. And again, is our real secret, this group of people. And really, there is no hierarchy in the company. Could be that this guy here in the row is the most important one when we need to design the mathematical model of the aerodynamic, for example. And this is to tell you briefly about our company. Then let's move to the presentation. So this, we have this beautiful title. Driving a company is like driving a car, and it is really true. An exercise of putting efforts on the right actuators. What are the actuators that you have to use? But you have also to look to the indicators. And in this phrase is really my job as a CEO of the company. Before, I have been 27 years in IBM as a president and CEO of IBM Italy and South Europe, managing 25,000 people. And then suddenly, when I reached 49 years old, I left everybody and I said goodbye. I go to this small company. At that time was 100 people, 107. In 2007. And why this? I had a lot of people telling me, you are becoming mad, what is happening to you, they have fired you, and so on. Simply, after 27 years as a manager, high-level manager, I decided to be an entrepreneur. Because I entered in this company with the founder, I bought stake of the company, so now the ownership of the company is by Dallara family and myself, and they can assure you that managing the money of somebody else is one thing, but when you have to manage your own money is different, because the only judge that you have is the mirror every morning, and they can assure you that you cannot lie to a mirror with your face in. And this is very interesting, and during this presentation we will go on to this. So I have decided to do probably the opposite on what you are doing. You start as entrepreneur with startups and so on. With myself, I decided to do the opposite. I have been in a very structured company. I have to thank you, IBM, because they have taught me a lot of things. I have been in Cambridge University in UK, paid by IBM. MIT paid by IBM. I had a various number of experiences all over the world. I have been in US, in Germany, in UK, in France. I have been 2 years and a half in France managing Europe. But then, after 27 years, I feel that I was well prepared to manage a small company as an entrepreneur. And so, let's go to this study. We have two premises. One is in Varano de Melegari, Parma. It is 1 hour and a half from here. And the other one is Indianapolis in US. We have opened Indianapolis 3 years ago. And I will tell you something about this investment, because again, you have to invest your own money on things that you think that will have a return in the near future. And the decision, when I joined the company with Giampaolo Dallara, that is an incredible guy, really a very, very, very smart guy. He was 72 years old, 71, and he had the problem to pass the management of the company to somebody. And he decided not to select anybody from the family, and they are employed in the company. One is the manager, the director of the research and development. The other one is the director of the staff. But he said, I pick up somebody from outside, because I think that none of the people that I have in the company now is able to run the company as I want for the future. And so it was very risky for him. And when they said to me, when the people says to me, you had a lot of courage to leave IBM to go to Dallara, I say, probably the courage was from Mr. Dallara, that he built up his own company and then he let somebody else to manage it. And so we have decided some simple rules. For example, we have the same salary, a salary high enough to have a very nice life, so I don't complain, I gain more money than IBM. So for me it was okay, for him equal. And all the earnings, all the profit of the company are reinvested in the company on the innovation side. Because we want to create our future through our own profit. So we don't have debts with banks. I don't have to convince anybody in the banks to borrow me money to do this beautiful simulator. If we have the money, we invest. If we don't have the money, we don't invest. Of this profit, there is a percentage that we give to the employees. So if we have very good profits, we give very good money to the people. Otherwise, no. Up to now, we were able every year to give a good amount of money, more or less, let me say, for the low level, 1 month of salary on top as an award. And for others, for example, up to 7-8 times the month salary as an award. So it's a good incentive for the people to participate on the profit of the company. So here I have divided the 40 years of our company in four different periods. I entered in the last one, but you see the startup phase, four employees. Gianpaolo Dallara was a very clever engineer. He was he received his degree in aeronautic engineering at 21 years old in Politecnico di Milano. So today in Italy it's not possible to have the laurea before the 24 years old. But at that time it was possible if you were able to have all the examination and so on. And he was hired by Enzo Ferrari directly. So Enzo Ferrari picked up him and he said to him, I want you to design our wind tunnel in Ferrari. And Gianpaolo went to Ferrari. But he had in mind always the pleasure to go to race. This was his idea. I want to race. But he was so good on designing the wind tunnel that Ferrari didn't give to him any possibility to go to race. He had to stay on the wind tunnel side. And so suddenly Maserati came over saying, dear Gianpaolo, you are 24 years old and we offer you the chief engineering position at the racetrack. And so Gianpaolo left Ferrari, and they give you one anecdote that is very nice, but he didn't have the courage to say to Enzo Ferrari, I leave Ferrari. And he invented a lie, saying, my father asked me to go back to my home because the father was building roads and bridges, these kind of things. He said, my father needs an engineer to sign the projects. You can imagine that an aeronautical engineer cannot sign a design of a road. And Enzo Ferrari went to the father of Gianpaolo Dallara saying, are you mad? So you have a so good guy working on the here in Ferrari. And the father of Gianpaolo said, but every morning goes to Modena to do what? And in reality was going at the Maserati premises, not to Ferrari. So Ferrari closed the door to Gianpaolo. For 5 years, he didn't talk to him. Then they become again friends. But at 24 years old, Gianpaolo Dallara was chief engineer at the racetrack for Maserati with two drivers at the 24 hour of Daytona. One was Roger Penske, that is a very important person in the US, and the other one was Bruce McLaren, the founder of McLaren Cars. And these two guys were the driver of Giampaolo Dallara. But after a couple of years, Maserati decided to close the race adventure, and so Giampaolo left Maserati to go to Lamborghini. Because Lamborghini, Ferruccio, the founder of Lamborghini, convinced him to go to Lamborghini saying, I want to offer our engine to the Formula One teams, so I need an engineer like you to go to Formula One. And Giampaolo said, okay, I come over there. And when he was there, Ferruccio Lamborghini said, in the meantime, design a road car. And so Giampaolo designed Lamborghini Miura. Lamborghini Miura was so successful that Lamborghini had no time to go to Formula One. And so Giampaolo left. And he went to De Tomaso with the friend Frank Williams. He went to De Tomaso to race in Formula One. And De Tomaso went bankruptcy. So it was 1972, and Giampaolo said, okay, I understood. If I want to race, I have to create my own company. And so is when he started up the company with four employees. It was a garage, and we still have this garage in our premises, and we are restructuring it now. The technology was the first use of carbon fiber material in a chassis as a structural component of the car. It was the first one to use this kind of material in a structural component of the cars. At that time, the chassis was made in steel or aluminum with carbon fiber panels around. He invented the way to use carbon fiber as a structure, so without any steel and any aluminum. And the sales turnover was basically domestic. So it was the Formula 3, Lancia, these kind of cars. Then we had the development of the company from 85 to 97. The company size moved to 30 employees, 30. We had a new offices and new premises. The technology was chassis and carbon fiber and aerodynamics. So Giampaolo was the first one to install a wind tunnel with the moving belt in Italy. So he was a firm believer on the aerodynamics as one of the most important things in a race car. I don't think so that you are very expert on the race cars, but only to give you an idea, if you take as 100% the performance of a race car, 15%, 1.5, is given by the engine. 35%, 3.5, is given by the weight. And so now you understand why carbon fiber is so important. And 50%, 5.0, is given by the aerodynamics. So this is the composition of the performance. And so Dallara was specialized on aerodynamics and weight. We don't produce any engine. So we buy the engine as a black box. The sales turnover started also to have a turnover important in UK, in Germany, and US. Then we had another phase that was more on the consolidation around these two main items, aerodynamics, carbon fiber, but we have had another part that was the vehicle dynamics. So how to predict the behavior of a car, having the engine, the tires, the aerodynamic, the weight, the driver, all the things together, how to predict the combination of these things, is the vehicle dynamics study. And so we have added this other part. And so the export market overtake at that time the domestic market. Then I joined the company in 2007, at the end of 2007. So this year is our 9 years that I joined the company. As I told you, we were 107 at that time. Now we have we are a little more than 500. Here you see the investment that we have made. So we have built up a new wind tunnel in the year after that I joined the company. Then 2010, the professional simulator that you have seen before. A new factory in US 2 years later. And then 2 years later, we have installed another professional simulator in US. Only to give you an idea, a professional simulator like this costs around 10 million. The sales turnover, one thing that is important is we spend more or less 10 million on R&D every year and 7 million on CapEx. That is a big number compared to our sales that are around 70 million. So we have 23-24% of our revenue that is devoted to investments. That is a lot. And the most important thing is that we are not anymore only a racing car producer, but let me say half of our business is on the consultancy part. And here at the back, you see that we moved from a manufacturing company to an engineering company, and now we are a knowledge company. And we are becoming more and more like a software company. Now we sell the mathematical models of our cars. And then the manufacturing of the car could be done by anybody else. It's an interesting change because this changed completely also how you design, how you employ the people, and how you manage the information systems inside the company. Here is a mix-up of products and knowledge. Now we are producing, okay, I give you the championship of GP2, that is worldwide series, that is the feeder series of Formula One, GP2. All the cars are produced by us. GP3, that is the feeder series of GP2. Again, all the cars are made by us. Formula 3, that is, let me say, the basic formula all over the world, from Japan to Brazil to Germany, UK, and so on. And here we are not the only producer of Formula 3, there are others, but let me say now there are more or less 200 cars racing every weekend all over the world as Formula 3. Four of them are not Dallara. 196 are produced by us. Then Grand Am is another series in US. We have one car racing there. We just won last Sunday in Detroit, the race with one car. IndyCar, I told you that we have won the 500 miles of Indianapolis, but now it's easy because all the cars are produced by us. So it's an easy task. Indy Lights, that is the feeder series of IndyCar, all the cars are produced by us. Formulino, World Series by Renault, Super Formula in Japan, and Formula Electric. I don't know if you are aware of this Formula Electric that is changing completely the racing model all over the world. It's a car, is a racing car, full electric. But again, it's changing the business model because you don't have pollution and you don't have noise. So they race in the center of the most important city of the world. They had race in Los Angeles, Miami, Paris, London, Berlin, Shanghai, Hong Kong. and they race in the center of the town, so it become more a social event than a pure race, and they are very linked with the social tool as well. Only to give you an idea, at the first race we have connected the Facebook to the cars. So if you go to Facebook, you have the 20 drivers, and you can put like to one driver or to the other. The driver that receives more likes, he can have, during the race, 50 horsepower more for 10 seconds. So you have a link with the social. And for example, in the first race in Shanghai, the first driver was Prost, who was leading the race, and the second one was Eiffelt, that was the second. It's normal that the likes goes to the second, because you want to see the action. And so Eiffelt, and you can follow over the net, you select a driver, you can have all the cameras looking on how he drives and so on. You see on the top, you have a camera here, and you see the steering wheel, that when you have the 50 horsepower, the steering wheel become green, and so you have a button to push, and you decide when you want to use the 50 horsepower. And so when you decide to have the 50 horsepower, at the last turn, you put the 50 horsepower, you overtake, and then you win. And what happened in reality is that Prost, that was the leading guy, when he saw the Eiffelt coming out with the 50 horsepower more to try to overtake, he put him under the wall, and so they had an accident, and the third won the race. And was the first race where people outside the environment was able to influence the race. And incredible, you know how many likes they have received? All in all, 1 billion. Billion. You can put as many likes as you want. So 1 billion means that you have an enormous activity around this race. And here again, you see the race as it is today, but how is changing the technology. And so it's a new adventure. And this is Formula E. And all the cars are produced by us, by the way. And then we started this year a new adventure that is Formula One, with a new team that is a US team, us. Us is an American company producing SNC machines. And so they have followed our idea. So, beside the driver, you have the three components: engine, weight, and aerodynamics. And they said, okay, I go to the best for the engine, and they selected Ferrari. They come to us for the design the car, carbon fiber, and they come to us for the aerodynamic. And what they did, they put the money and the race team, so the mechanics that manage the car during the race. And he gave us an objective that was to score this year at least 3 or 4 points in the world championship. And we are a newcomer with a new car, with people that never worked together. So we have in Formula One teams that they are working there since the 90s, and they didn't score any points. If you take, Manor, if you take Sauber, none of them have scored a point now. And after 7 races, we have scored already 22 points. And this is a surprise also for us, by the way. And he invented a new business model. Instead to produce everything inside, he decided to buy the best from outside and to put together the things, managing a system. Again, I use these items to give you an idea on how you can change the business models And nobody thought about this different business model. And now there is Mercedes, Force India, they are complaining against him, against us, saying, you are changing the things. Yeah, this is allowed. These are the rules, are written the same for everybody. And I played with the rules. So I selected people outside. Thanks God they selected us. But again, it's another idea. Then we do consultancy for companies that produce racing cars. Instead to produce our own cars, like the first model, we consultant other companies like Porsche. We have done the aerodynamic for the Porsche that have won last year the 24 Hour of Le Mans. Or we produce the carbon monocoque for Audi that won the year before the 24 Hour of Le Mans. Or we have done the aerodynamics for Audi for DTM. Or we have done some activity on the Ferrari side. So we offer our consultancy to other companies that perform races and companies that produce supercars. And the most important, probably, you can see here Alfa Romeo 8C, Alfa Romeo 4C. We have done Lamborghini, Huracan, Aventador. We have done Maserati MC12. We have done La Ferrari, the most important Ferrari in carbon fiber that is available in the market today. Porsche 918. But the most important project for us is the car that you can see here, Bugatti Veyron. That is the car here. Bugatti Veyron is the most powerful and fastest car available today in the market. We have 15 hundredths horsepower. Formula One is 800, only to give you an idea. This car is 15 hundredths. We reached the speed here in the Salt Lake of 451 kilometers per hour. And it's really a different business model again. Because this is the first car, Bugatti Veyron. We have designed it. We have done the wind tunnel activity, the vehicle dynamics. We have produced the first prototypes for them. And then last year, they have asked us to, no, 2 years ago, they to develop the new one. The new one that is the one that is that reached 451 kilometers per hour. This car, Veyron, was 1,000 power horsepower and 400 kilometers per hour. And 1 million as a cost. So 1 million, 1,000, and 400 kilometers per hour. The new one that we have designed for them is Bugatti Chiron, that is 15 hundredths horsepower, 450 as a kilometers per hour, and is 2.4 million as a price. But between these two cars, last year, they have developed a new kind of business model. As I told you before, we have used the simulator to build up the innovation that we use in these cars. And so you can drive the car before it's produced. And we use several kind of, of mathematical models. They asked us to give them the mathematical models. And we sold to them the mathematical models. We have produced one car that is called Bugatti Vision that has been presented last year in Frankfurt. I was there on the stage with the president of Bugatti. Bugatti Vision, you can see over the net, this incredible car. And this Bugatti Vision, we have produced only one car. And they sell only the mathematical models over the net with GT Sport game on the PlayStation. So you buy the car with the PlayStation. I met the Japanese guy that has developed this GT Sport. He sold already 70 million cars. And now their business model is, okay, I can sell this model. I don't know how much it costs. Let's take $1,000 for the game. And if you sell 1 million cars, is 1 billion revenue with cost zero. So they use the real car to create a dream that you can use over the net with an affordable price. And it's interesting, this thing. Is the digital with the real world that they mix up. I explained to you the Formula Electric or this Bugatti Vision. That is a very interesting kind of car. And up to now, we have produced only one because this is real. We have tested this in Le Mans and is able to perform what we deliver over the net on the GT Sport, on the PlayStation. So now you understand what we do. Basically, we do these three things. We receive the style of the regulation or whatever, so the basic things by the customer, and we do design using carbon fiber. And here, as you can imagine, our knowledge is based on the how to package all the things together and how to calculate the structural elements of the car using carbon fiber. It's a very complex stuff, and we have a big supercomputer to do this. Second thing is aerodynamics. On both the worlds, one is the CFD, computational fluid dynamics, that is basically supercomputers, where you try to understand why you have a phenomena. And then you have wind tunnels, where you test and you measure the why that you have discovered on the CFD. So these two elements, the real one, so the wind tunnel, work together with the digital one. And then the third is vehicle dynamics, as I told you before, on the simulator, but I come back on this. And then another important thing is the prototype production. We are able to prototype everything we design. This is another important feature of our company, because we are able to produce inside from the screw to the carbon fiber monocoque. So we have the capabilities to do everything, but we don't have the capacity. So we can produce one or two pieces, not more. If you want serious production, you have to go to somebody else. And we provide you with the design, the mathematical models, the surfaces, all the kind of things. So this is important that you understand also how you position your company and you stay where you have decided to position your company. Our sales today is basically 50-50 racing versus the engineering part, the consultancy part. Our business is done 4% in Italy, 4% in Italy, then 1/3 in Europe, 1/3 in US, and 1/3 in the rest of the world. This is very important, again, to keep your company safe, because you don't know how the economy moves across the world. And so it's important that you have your feet, I don't say everybody, everywhere, but at least to have three legs. And here, I don't want to mix up all the studies that you have done up to now. These are made by Andrea Pontremoli, and so it's nothing, but are my ideas. Today, I see two lines, or better, two trends that increasingly separating. One, the low-cost products are becoming more and more cheap. Do you see this effect? Any product. Could be shoes. So these costs are going down. Then you see another effect, another trend. High prices products are becoming more and more expensive. And this is not based on the kind of product. You can have shoes at 10 euro, and you can have shoes at 6,000 euro. You can have a car at 3,000 euro, like Nano, and you can have a car like Bugatti at 2.4 million. They have four wheels or cars. You can have a stereo that is $50 and a stereo that is $100,000. So remember this. But these two lines are separating very, very rapidly. And so when you build up any initiative, you have to decide where you want to position your company. The most dangerous area is to be in the middle. Wait a minute, because there is another part that is interesting. So ask yourself, to stay in the low part, what do you need? Two things. Low labor cost and economy of scale. You have to produce a lot of the things that you have decided to produce. This is basically two things. And if I think about Italy, we are very lucky. We don't have any of these two things. So we have no choice. We cannot stay in this low line. Period. To stay at the upper line, you need three things. One, innovation as I define innovation. You are innovative if you can say, just me. I am the only one that has this thing. That is a business model, is a technology, is a service, is whatever, but you can say, only me. I am just me. If you say, me too, you are a loser. Because when you say, me too, okay, I have a cellular phone. I produce, me too, I have a cellular phone. It means that you go immediately at the low level, because you are a follower. If you say, me too, it means that you are a follower. So it means that you are not an innovator. Second thing that you need is marketing. Let others know you do a unique product. Because if you are the only one that know that you have this uniqueness, it's not worth. It's not very important. So marketing is needed when you have uniqueness. And third thing, that here in Italy I have to say that we are masters on this, you need a brand. A brand tell you the two things before with one name or with one symbol or whatever. So if you have the horses in the racing, means Ferrari. And in your mind, you have, if you buy a Ferrari, you buy already innovation and something that is unique. And uniqueness is not only related to technology. Remember this. Could be related to history, for example. The 500 miles of Indianapolis, why I'm saying that is the most important race in the world? Because it's the only one that this year was the 100 years that we have this race. You cannot buy history, and you cannot build up history if you don't have it. Or could be a place, a territory. Here we are in Toscana. You have Brunello di Montalcino. It's a wine, and you pay 100 euro for a bottle. Okay. But if you take the Brunello and you go to Shanghai, you can have Brunello there, but you will have Brunello di Shanghai, not Brunello di Montalcino. So even an area, a name, is a uniqueness. It is not important if it's very good or very bad. And as we are becoming global and global, this becomes more important than in the past. So, I told you that the most dangerous part to be here is in the middle. It's not exactly true. You can stay in the middle, but you need again a differentiator. And to be differentiate in the middle, this chart is only, I put here a chart. I have a lesson that lasts 2 days on this chart. So I try to summarize, because Andrea told me that you are very intelligent. Service. So here, the differentiator, if you want to stay in the middle, is the level of service. That could be, again, a uniqueness. Typical is, a flight. Why you select, American Airlines versus Alitalia or versus British Airways? It's because you have more safety. Nobody will give up on the safety side. Is it because you have better planes? Sometimes you don't know even which kind of planes they use. If they have better trained pilots, you don't know the pilots. The difference is based on the brand and on the services related to the brand. Or could be a bar. Andrea, we had to take a coffee before, and we went to, we meet 5 bars before he said we go here. Why? The product is the same, it's a coffee. It's the service, the environment, because you want to show me the crowd, all these kind of things. And if you want to stay in the middle, you can stay there, but the differentiator is not the product, but is the service. And remember this as well. Again, these are my ideas. I'm not saying that are not written anywhere. Are only my ideas. So, as a business strategy, here you see Engineer Dallara and myself, we invest everything we earn, and this is important. So, I go very rapid. Here you see the trend in terms of people. It's not only because we have increased the business, because the business doubled since I joined the company, so we moved from 30 million to 70 million as a revenue. We have an EBITDA that is around 23-24%. But the people increased 5 times. So you doubled the revenue and the people increased 5 times. It's not because you have doubled the revenue, but it is because we have changed the business model of the company. We moved from a manufacturing company to a knowledge company. And for knowledge, you need more people. And so the differentiator become more and more the people. Then we create, as I told you, as we are a knowledge company, we have to design an organization that is able to manage the knowledge. And so we find out that the best way is the matrix organization. So we have the typical company organization. They want only to show these 3 things that are the 3 basic areas: design, carbon fiber, the vehicle dynamics, and the aerodynamics. And here you have these lines, these rows, that are the business area. So we start the project here. We have a project manager. And the project manager decides to run this project. He needs 3 people from aerodynamics, 5 people from the design of carbon fiber, 2 people from vehicle dynamics, and he put the people to work on the projects. Then when you finish the problem, the people go back to their original organization. So in this way, you share the knowledge among the different kind of silos of the company, but when you finish the project, you go back and you teach the people that are inside your silos the different things that you have learned. So it's a matrix that is changing every day. Now I'm studying a new evolution of this, but I'm not ready to tell you. Let me call a liquid organization. Innovation process. So here I go to the simulator. Simulator at the beginning was an incredible tool to be able, as I told you at the beginning, to allow a driver that to drive a car that was never built. And here I give you the four area where we base any project. So first you have a concept. Concept means I want a car with four wheels that is long 4 meters, with 2 meters, with 400 horsepower, with this aerodynamics. So you put together the concept. What do you want? Then based on the concept, you start to design, and design using aerodynamics, vehicle dynamics, carbon structuring, packaging, and so on. When you have designed, you produce a prototype. And when you have produced a prototype, you test the prototype to see if the results are equal to the concept setup. Normally not. You start to modify the design, you modify the prototype, you retest, and this is the loop. With the simulator, we have only one phase. We have the concept testing. And this has reduced incredibly the timing and the cost. And to make it more practical, I give you this simple concept. Now we are all discussing about hybrid cars with an electrical engine and a gasoline engine, okay? Okay, you have a customer says, okay, I want to produce a car with this thing, with this speed, with this weight, with this long 4 meters and so on. Okay, but where do you put the engines? It's better to put the engine, gasoline engine and the electrical engine together? Or is it better to put the electrical engine in the front, the gasoline engine in the back? Or is better to have two electrical engines in the front and one gasoline engine in the back? Or to have four engines, electrical, one per wheel, and the gasoline engine that charge batteries that allow you to drive the car? So to answer to these four questions, in the old system, I have to design a complete car, to prototype it, to test it, and before I am able to answer which is the best solution, the market is gone. Here I need a tool, let me say in a very simple way. Simulator is an incredible tool to make mistakes at lower cost. And innovation comes from mistakes. And if I allow the organization to make a lot of mistakes, I am, by definition, more innovative than anybody else. You are studying now business models and so on. I can tell you one thing for sure. Your business model will be wrong. I can sign it. The only thing that the business model can give you is the direction. But the width of the things are impossible to predict. And this is the difference between speed and velocity. Speed is how many kilometers per hour. Velocity is how many kilometers per hour in a given direction. So the most important thing when you design a company, you design a business model, is to have the right direction. The speed will come over time. Because if you have the wrong direction, it's better that you have a very low speed, because you are in the wrong direction. To give you an idea of the simulator, and as we learn from mistakes, I have done the two worst mistakes that you can do when you design a new business model. I'm sure that the people here are teaching you that the two most important things are to segment the clients. When you design something, okay, who are the clients, where they are, to segment them. And second thing is the business model. How you make the money over this tool, service, whatever. I missed both. Because my idea at the beginning with the simulator, I was sure about the direction. We need this tool to allow us to test things that are not existing. But in my mind, the customers were the drivers and the teams. So they can come over and to test a new car. And the business model was very simple. I sell by hour. You come over 3 hours, you pay for 3 hours. You come over for 2 days, you pay for 2 days. Simple. Two mistakes. At the end, our customers are not the drivers, but are the big OEMs, the big companies, the engine producers, the tire producer, the shock absorber producer, the suspension producer. And the business model, I don't sell hours, but I sell the mathematical models. Only to give you an idea, Pirelli, during the race in Bahrain, Formula One, it's very difficult race because you have sand over the racetrack, so it's difficult to predict the grip of the asphalt. And second thing, you have a very wide spread of temperature, because you start the race at 5 o'clock in the afternoon and you end at 7 o'clock in the afternoon. So you start with the sun, you end with the night. And so you have 10, 15 degrees as a difference. That is a lot. And so they want to test the different kind of tires to select which one is the best performer in these kind of conditions. So they come to us with 31 different kind of tires in a USB key. We put the USB key in the simulator. We put a driver in the simulator. It tested all the 31 in the different conditions, with the sand, without the sand, with the temperature, without the temperature, density of the air, engine power, whatever. And then they select which tire to produce for Bahrain race. So they have selected one. How you can do the same things in the reality? You have to produce 31 different kind of tires. Then you have to book a racetrack in Abu Dhabi or in Dubai. You have to pray God that you have the right temperature, because you cannot select the temperature. It's selected by God in the reality. In the simulator, I can select the temperature. I can select the density of the air. I can select if there is the wind with the sand or not. And it lasts for sure at least 4 months. Here they have done everything in one day. You understand the change? But if I look on the business model design, I missed the two most important things, the customer and the business model, but I was right on the direction. To have a tool to test something that is not real yet. And this is a phrase that I put here. I don't know if you want to kill me, but the current high frequency of trial and error allows for a faster innovation pace. I am convinced about this. And so you need to have an organization that is able to make a lot of mistakes to be able to find the best solution. And that means that you need to give to them the tools, but also, and probably is the most important thing, a culture in the company that allow this. Now, when you are a company, you make a mistake, you try to find the guilty person, who is the guy that has made the mistake. And they give you here another anecdote by Mr. Dallara. He says that he is the best as a designer because he has 50 years of mistakes in his shoulders. And I remember that was a young designer, 6 months in the company, designing a rocker. A rocker is a piece of steel like this with three holes, and you attach the suspension to this. And Engineer Dallara was behind him, looking to this rocker, and he said, I think that this rocker cannot work. You know, you are 6 months older in the company, and said, Engineer Dallara, tell me what I have to modify. And he said, no, do it as you want. Because if I am right, as I think, you learn on your skin. And you will never forget. But if you are right, I learn. And whatever will be the solution, one of the two guys here learns something. It's interesting. Not because the phrase, but because this allows the people to put all those strange things, to test things. Okay, here you are doing this pre-topiting, how do you call that? I call it pre-manufacturing information system technology. So I put the driver in the center of the system, of the information system. It means that I put all these different mathematical models, and all of them are driven in real time, and people that are knowledgeable on information system can understand what means real time when you have 20 to 30,000 different equations solved in less than 1 millisecond to allow the driver to drive as a reality. But the driver is at the center of the system. And we call this system human in the loop. Up to now we put hardware in the loop, but here you have human in the loop. So a human body is in an enormous information system loop. And so as a CEO, having all these two different beautiful things, what I look as indicators. I explained now that the first part that are the actuators, what I use as actuators, people, technology, information systems, these are the actuators that I use. But what are the indicators? The indicators are completely different. First is customer satisfaction. Every year I ask to all our customers what they think about us. They have 20, 25 questions. And most important thing is I pay our people. I told you that we give a percentage of our profit to our employees. But half of the weight of this amount is decided by customer satisfaction numbers. Because you have an enormous source of information from your customers. Ask them what they think, what they have perceived. So customer satisfaction is one indicator. Second thing could be a very simple one, which is cash level. As the Americans say, cash is king. I never saw a company going bankruptcy because they have a negative profit. I saw all the companies going to bankruptcy because you run out of cash. Are two different things. You can have a company with no profit, but a good cash, and you can survive. But if you don't have cash, No way. And cash level is very important, especially in a company like our company that invests a lot on the future. Then you have to see the sales growth, because at the end is another measurement that you need to see. Because this system can maintain itself only if you have a system that grows. Up to now, I need a growth. In the future, I don't know. But I have to decide what is the growth that I need to enable me to make the level of investment that I need to sustain the business model. Everything is linked. Then, okay, EBIT is another important number that I have to see. And the ROI, the return on the investment. I make an investment, I have to see a return of this investment. And I short a little bit the things, but remember another thing. Sales means prices. I don't know what they have taught you, but prices are not linked to cost. It's a lie. Prices are linked to value. And value has nothing to do with cost. Value is linked to environment and is linked to timing. If I want the simulator now, and I am the only one in the world that has available this, I can ask you 100, 1,000, 10,000, who cares? I am the only one, and you want it now. If you can wait 3 years, probably you can build up your own simulator. So timing is more important than cost. And second thing is the environment. Now, I need a glass of water. And if you ask me, the glass of water, you know, the cost of the water is, I don't know, a bottle of water could be 30 cents. 30 cents at the in the bar could be 1 euro as a price. If it's in the Sahara Desert, could be 1 million euro. And the cost is the same. And so the most important thing that you have to understand when you set up your prices is related really on the timing and on the environment. And the third thing, but is at the end the first that I have explained in the My Business Model Design, is the uniqueness. If you have a uniqueness, price is based on your uniqueness. And so at the end, 1 liter of wine of Brunello di Montalcino costs the same of a liter of wine of Malvasia. The same. No difference in terms of cost. In terms of price, completely different. Why this? It's because the uniqueness. And again, then we have all the tools to understand how the company is going in terms of so the business intelligence data structure, so where I capture the numbers. I need the planning and control, I need the sales management, I need the inventory management, but these are only indicators. Like when you drive a car, you look on the indicators to see if the speed is the right one, the number of revs is correct, and so on. But the most important thing are not these indicators, is... Grazie, vedi che capito. And the cost is the same. Eh? And now it's free. But again, here, the indicators tell you the speed, the revs, the temperature in the car, all these kind of things. But this indicator doesn't mean anything if you have the steering wheel in the wrong direction. At the end is are only indicators, but the most important thing is your steering wheel that is in your hands. Then I explained all the tools, blah, 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 but I told you at the beginning, the most important thing are people. We believe on young people. We hire only graduate engineers and so on. Let me say, 98% of our employees has been hired as the first job in Dallara. Only 2% are people hired with some experiences. And basically the experiences are on planning, on numbers, this kind of things that you can buy outside. But in term of knowledge, and he give you this interesting anecdote. When we built up the simulator, all our engineers inside the company, they said, is a dream. It's not possible to do it. Then we went outside. All the people outside, they told us the same. You cannot think to have a professional driver that drives a mathematical model, giving you the right things. Impossible. What we did, we have hired 14 young graduate engineers, 14. They didn't know that it was impossible and they made it. And now we have made another one in US. So the young people, they don't have barriers. And I have barriers because I grew up and then you have conviction, you have judgment, you have a lot of things. And so we believe on young people, we believe on our internal school, but because what the, another important thing is the culture of the company. You need to live, to have live this culture. And continuous training. We search people with intellectual curiosity. You never give up, you search all the time. Our payoff in the company is in the search of excellence. Our search and excellence are two words that are moving. Excellence is moving because when you reach the excellence, somebody else is another excellence. And search, you are searching. And we see these three things on the people. Head, what you know. Heart, and hands. It's important also this. Engineers that they don't know how to do things. And they are able only with a perfect design on a screen board. You need also to use your hands to do things. And this is what I explained to you before, the territory. That is very important from my point of view. And we work a lot on this. We spend a lot of money to create an education system. And the education system is all this network. Formula SAE, that we will have on University of Pisa as well, the third weekend of July. If you want to come, it's open, you can see. This year is limited by us, by the way. We have 80 universities from all over the world, 2,000 young engineers that they come over to run their car that they have built up, their racing car, and we will select the best. But I have 2,000 people that they can recruit. I will select the best with the best ideas, with the best passion. For sure they have passion, otherwise they don't come there. 80 universities, of which 12 are from Italy, and the rest are from all over the world. We have 9 from India. And then you see a lot of things that we have done, a lot of courses, not only for our people, but for the territory. For example, we have taken now 200 people in 5 years of unemployed people. After the courses, all the people works. All the people work. It's incredible. So the people are the same. the territory is the same, what is changed? The education. And so I think that this is really not only a responsibility of the university, of the education system, but it's also a responsibility of the companies. We have to do something if we want to foster our ability in the territory. And over these 200 people, only 10% has been hired by us. The other 180 went to other companies. But these companies are our supplier, or are suppliers of the system. And now this network is with Ferrari, Lamborghini, Maserati, Ducati. We create an enormous education system starting from the basic school, really the basic. We have now people that are 9 years old to teach them about technical things, to try to give to them the passion of the STEM, science, technology, engineering, math. And in Italy we have also an A, that is arts. And we have created in US and now also in Italy this environment where you can test these things. With Andrea we will have a summer school working in this, exactly in this direction. Even if we take people that are already at 17, 18 years old. It's an enormous problem in US, for example. They don't have enough technical people. And again, the two lines that we have seen before, we see more and more poor jobs and more high-level jobs. But we cannot sustain a society with this kind of two lines. We need also the middle. Good, hard worker people that are... And the technology here is the guilty. Because every 3-4 years, whatever is your job, it's not important which kind of job. If you are on a mill machine, I just bought a mill machine that I spent 2.5 million for a mill machine. Who will be the employee that I put on this 2.5 million? The same guy that I have in the other mill machine that cost 10,000 euro doing by hand things? You know, you see these things. And so a company has to create an education system that is able to create education inside the company, outside the company, and I think that really the future is linked to this, and this is why we are investing in all these kind of things. And so I have finished my presentation in 1 hour and 15 minutes, so I take a little bit longer, but you know, when I start to explain my things, I become very passionate. Thank you for your time.